What I saw was a consuming market that was hungry for something that would personalize and make their homes look special, their own added touch to it. And so the Castone made it possible for, say, the average person to have a little piece of a castle all his own.
Explain to me what cast stone really is.
We forge the stone just like a blacksmith hammers steel and hammers it hard and pounds the molecules together. We're doing the same thing with silica sands and cementitious materials. We're putting them in a form and hammering them in there. The process involves a lot of talent and skills. Everything is handmade. There is little, if any, automation that can be accomplished because we don't make enough of one piece. And it's our versatility to move from one shape to another shape that offers us the greatest advantage over other materials. Cast stone's more economical simply because we get to put a lot of time into one form and then use the form again and again and again. Therefore, we don't have to shape each piece individually, but we can actually use the form to help us do the shaping. This is where we make our molds. We have over 1,200 profiles hanging on the wall that we use in catalog and keep up with. And then we make extrusions or components that we assemble down here and make the different parts that we're going to make to carry off the project. This is an example of one of the 1,200 profiles that we extrude. In this particular case, he's making a straight section. We're going to cut it and fit it so that we can make parts out of it that fit into one of our units. So this would be making a positive and going to a negative. This is a positive model. We've cast around that and we made removable parts in the mold. They'll actually take the mold apart while the material is still fresh. The best way I could describe it to you is that when you were a child playing on the beach and you packed that bucket full of sand and you flipped it over, I bet you can remember seeing the patent numbers in the bottom of the bucket. That's what kind of detail you can pull. We're going to use this form multiple times today. So we're going to do a casting, and while it's in the sandcastle phase, we're not going to leave it in this form. We're going to very carefully, with delicate hands, disassemble the form, and when we pull everything away, the sandcastle remains. Here's an example of a negative form. And what we've done here, we've made this mold in reverse. Instead of putting the model together first, we've gone straight for the mold itself. So we built the mold from scratch in reverse. So we made it hollow. We're in the art shop, and art by definition is very broad. But what I want to bring to your attention is that we work for architects that believe in classics. So there are certain disciplines here that reach far beyond art. This is a customer's design, not my own. And what happens is the artist interacts with the customer directly, and he actually becomes part of the creative process. This is a classical design. But keep in mind, this column has four sides. So what we've done is we're going to make a mold to make a mold. So art is, to my way of thinking, sits in two camps. One is we're replicating a discipline that's already been done, and the other is we're innovative, like we were on the fish. We brought that together for the customer. We keep 25,000 forms ready to go. What that does is that converts to speed. It allows us to get to production much sooner than we would otherwise. It also allows us to do cost savings and pass them through to our customer. So the longer we're here, the more forms we catalog and keep up with, the stronger we are, and the easier we can represent our customer's wallet while we're in production. It makes us more competitive, and because we've done it before, it keeps our mistakes down. So we've got every advantage in keeping these forms. You want to pay attention to all the details and make sure that every step of the way, you're very systematic in what you do, and that when you deliver the product, it goes all the way across the United States. He didn't want to call in and say, can you send me one more stone because this one doesn't fit? And you can't make a profit doing that either. So what that means is that we as a company have to see problems before they happen and anticipate field conditions before we get there so that when we get there, our stuff fits. It's a one-time shot, so we want to do it right the first time, and that makes the labor on the job flow smoothly. It makes our factory profitable, and it gives the customer a very good taste in his mouth.
You know, what you do is so interesting. I can't help but wonder, do you consider that you have competition in this field?
I have an artist on staff, mold makers, pattern makers. I have a complete architectural drafting department. We actually even innovate software in order to help us do what we do better, faster, and quicker. So competition, I'll tell you like I tell my customers. I can't put talent on a piece of paper and call it a bid. But once you settle on the price, the talent's there.
A behind-the-scenes look at the magic of what can be created in cast stone is carried out by the artist at Stone Legends. I'm Doug Llewellyn, reporting from Dallas.